I am unashamed. What about you?
So, welcome back to Unashamed, the award-winning Unashamed podcast. I have to mention it just ever so often.
Well, if you blinked, we just were discussing that if you blink, you'd have missed us actually receiving the award.
Yeah, it was a little bit different. We were just, Josh was just showing us the actual show that aired on TBN, which most of you, if you watched it, we were kind of condensed into a category with the other, like, film and books and kind of other, because, you know, the music is the star of the show. I mean, yeah, and it was amazing. I mean,
a radio station.
That was like a concert, Jase. That was quite the evening.
I thought it was really fun.
So it just kind of reminded us again about it because it just happened this last week since last we recorded, even though we've already talked about it. But I got a lot of notes from a lot of folks out there on Unashamed Nation. And again, we thank you because, you know, really it's your award. It's not our award because
you're
the ones that vote and you're the ones that listen. So,
well, I was, we were doing the wedding rehearsal. I have a wedding tonight to, what do you call that when you're officiating?
You're the officiant.
I'm the officiant. Zach, how's that word? Efficient. Did I use that efficient?
Yeah, Zach, is that correct?
Efficiently. Yeah, you did it. You did good there.
Well, I like what you did there.
How many weddings have you officiated, guys? Do you know?
Well, I'm retired, you know.
Well, I know that. But even before your retirement, you weren't exactly doing a lot of weddings.
Maybe more than you think. Probably 10.
All right.
So
last time I counted, because I keep records, but then I did them before records, so I'm not accurate, but I was about 160.
Oh, well, it's way more. Well, actually, when they asked me, you know, I said, no, that place is two doors down to the left. And they were like, what? I was like, I said, that's not really my zone. You could do better. I tried every way known to man.
That was my favorite line you told him. You could do better.
That was the first thing that I said.
That's funny is what that
I mean, because to me, they look like kids. They look younger than they are, you know, compared to when I got married. I mean, they're old. They're in their 20s. But I was like, you could do better. So, but what I was going to say about the podcast, there's a wedding planner that we all know well, and she's ageless, but she's the wedding planner, so she was telling everybody what to do, because we did the rehearsal.
Yep.
And
that was last night.
It's out at my place. But she came up to me, and she said, brother, when you held that Bible up, and I had no idea what she was talking about, you know, but she was looking so serious. She said, tears started streaming down my face, and I said, yes, Lord. And so
she's talking about on the
she Kayla. Was talk, she was wa- she was watching the award.
Yeah,
know?
I got
so it was very.
But you didn't know what she was talking about.
No, but it was done with so passion. I was getting kind of choked up, and then but I didn't want to say, now what are you referring to? But I mean, because she was just really passionate about that because she's a believer and she loves the Lord.
I got a ton of messages of people that said that they got choked up in that part. So, which was on the only part they showed. So, you know.
Yeah.
Well, I thought you
had some good stuff in your acceptance, but that was your best line.
Well, that's what I believe. Yeah. I mean, don't take any offense. I'm not trying to hurt y'all's feelings, but when I look around, there's got to be another answer to this.
That's right.
To this success.
We've had the same thought looking around ourselves, Jay. So, yeah, no offense taken.
Not a whole lot of winners here. So, so I concluded that it must be the good book. So that's my speech, and I'm sticking to it.
And so, so Dad, you're hearing us today for the first time. So how do we sound?
No, I think you need a better lead up to that, Al. We actually have our first. What somebody dropped the M word with the miracle that Phil said he feels like he's had a miracle.
And I felt the same way he feels this morning.
Somebody said that.
Oh, I said that.
It's
I said
a miracle.
It felt you like said a, I said it felt like a miracle because I was deaf. I was not hearing anything, and all of a sudden it was so loud it I shied away from it.
Well, we went to Ohio and to the Amish community up there. I can't think of that little town.
Mount Hope.
I had been there. I had been there.
And Jason,
did they miss me?
A lot of people.
Yeah, they remember you.
A lot of people brought you up. We signed some stuff you had signed.
You helped the follow up, but we followed up with there. And after
I kept trying to throw Jason under the bus, it was so funny because they would say something about Jason. I'd make like
up there. We don't throw people under the bus. We throw them under the tractors.
Meeting with them, and asking a few questions, you know, and they were just talking, free to talk. I was absolutely convinced that they are members of the kingdom of God, Jesus being the king. They believe he died for them, was buried.
Yeah, they're good people.
Oh, yeah. Oh, and their women could cook.
And, I also remember that.
Yeah. I mean, they had an Amish wedding feast as well.
Their men could cook, too. So,
that's context. Right. So we were there all day, and I had a large crowd that night, you know, and got on back on the plane, flew back down to here. We got in here about 11 o'clock.
About 10:30.
Yeah, so we're leaving West Monroe, Louisiana. I'm out on Jonesboro Road going toward the woods where I live.
Yep.
So it's two lanes of traffic, two lane, you know. So I'm on the right leaving, and the people coming in was on my left coming in.
Basic traffic.
So I'm cruising along at about 45 or 50.
Which is the speed limit.
Yep. And I looked to my left, and in that line of traffic, I saw this vehicle coming out of it. It just kind of was sliding over into my lane. So I come off the gas a little bit, and I'm watching them. And they're not going to the left or right. They're still. It's like this. Both lanes are filled, and they're coming head on. So I got ready. I said, I'm going to do all this in one lick here. I was saying it to myself because I said, which way do I go here? Because he's coming. When he got within about 8 to 10 feet from, I mean, head on, like you hadn't seen lately. It was going to be a head on. Y'all's mother was on the right, and I'm watching that. And when they got down to about 8 to 10 feet, he was coming pretty fast, faster than I was driving. But I waited till I could turn quick. I turned to my right like this, and gunned it. I stomped my gas, boom. So I did like this. I just went like this. They're still coming. And I just romped down on the accelerator, and I thought at one point I was going to make it. But I heard pretty good little racket on the back and, you know, swung me around a little bit. I said, I've been hit. I said, I'm going to chase that rascal down. So I was going to get ready to go up there, but I saw his taillights. He just went back in the road and kept on going like nothing ever happened.
Yeah.
So I said, well, I'll run him down. Well, I looked back at my back tire, I heard the flopping. And my back tire was just flopping rubber. So he hit my tire. When I did like this, he just clipped me right on the end and didn't even tear up the truck at all. He just hit the tire. That's how I almost got him, you know, got away from him. But boom, he goes back. Well, you know, I'm standing there now. It's about 12 o'clock roughly. The little old filling station that was on the side of the road was closed. The woman wouldn't open the door. She's looking at me. I'm standing there, you know, hey, open the door. We need a cell phone here. I don't own a cell phone, but I needed one. Miss K's wouldn't work. We ended up with getting my old standby, old Jimmy Red, the redneck. I woke him up. He said, you called me once. I didn't answer. But he said, the second time, he said, why would he be calling me at 12 o'clock at night? So Red got it, understood it. He showed up, put the bad tire off. He's going this morning to get another one. The state trooper I called in, we called the police, come down here, check this out. You know, maybe you see a vehicle up above us that's tore up like this one is a little bit, you know, on my tire and all that. But so he comes in there and said, well, you know, we can't find anybody. Just, you know, boy, you got some driver license? I said, yeah, I have some driver license. So we showed him all the paperwork, you know.
So he took one look at you and thought, no.
He knew who I was.
Okay.
So he knew who I was.
So you're good to go.
So no injuries?
No injuries.
What's crazy to me is
loss of one tire And I finally got in bed. It was about 1:30 after Red. I had to wait on him to come up there, change the tire, put it back.
What's crazy is I heard your wife tell this story, and she was more of
the hero.
The hero in her version of the story. But so now I don't know.
If she had been driving that vehicle, that would have been a head-on collision.
Well, I admit that when she tells her version of it, I said, I said, Mom, it is a miracle you're alive. If this whole situation was based on your instincts and reflexes, because in her story you were zoned out and she yelled at you to take a hard right at just right moment.
No, that's her version. She said, you know, I looked up.
I saved us.
She said there were two cars drag racing in the middle of the street, and I said, well, how'd you know they're drag racing? She said, I know when people are drag.
I don't know what brought him over there in my lane, but trust me when I tell you, you wouldn't have wanted your woman to be on the steering wheel.
No.
In other words, I timed it all and just romped down on my accelerator.
Well, I would let you know
that. And I hooked a hard right, and they barely, I mean, you do like this, they barely.
One more second. You have one more anticipation.
Well, here was
one second.
Here was the main thing that I did. I questioned Mom's version because I said, well, what's the truck look like? She said, oh, it's bad. So when I got there this morning, I'm looking around, and I was like, I can't tell there's any damage to your truck.
He came so close that he just had I got a little of its paint.
How did he hit your tire, a rear tire, and never touch the fender or anything?
It was
a
car, right?
The state trooper said, I don't know how.
I don't either.
Got that kind of
thing. Phil,
look at his truck, you cannot tell anything ever happened.
I took a right and I gunned it, so I kept it from being head on right there. Now it's just the side, it's like this. Well, I just kept fogging it to it.
Yeah, but people can't see that. So Phil's doing an analogy.
With his hands.
With his hands.
He took a right, the other guy.
Yeah, they're just listening. So they're
close shave.
Yeah, it was a close shave.
Very close.
I had a car come, you know,
so
my,
close,
my truck,
I got paint from his vehicle right down my vehicle.
But my truck out there right now doesn't have a dent on it. And a car went in between my tires. I'm just driving down the road, and I just looked to my left, and they didn't see me. And the car went under my truck. I mean, and then spun out from the contact.
Like Christmas Vacation.
And I did not have a dent, and their car was totaled. But it's...
What was it, a Yugo? One of those
it was a little tiny car. Yeah.
That's because your truck is jacked up.
But I'm just saying, you know, you would think a whole car coming under your truck and spinning out, I would have at least a dent.
Yep. So, that was a near miss on me. It did a head-on collision. I didn't get nervous or anything. I just had planned it out because it was happening like milliseconds.
What was funny in
just come out and coming right at you.
Yeah.
And we're dead on. He's dead on. Just like he's not even paying attention.
Well, the two, you needed a couple more milliseconds of hook him to the right.
Yeah.
Wow. Now, the Miss Case's first words, well, you saved her life. I said, I helped. I'll tell you that.
Then she slept and said, "Hey, I saved
our life." Yeah. Well, yeah. So it's a he said, she said. I said,
pretty funny. I mean,
I said if we were trying to solve a mystery on NCIS, we would have conflicting testimony.
Well, she was at the rehearsal last night, and so she was telling me the story. So there I was. You know, I looked way down. It was a drag race going on. I told Phil, we might already get out of the way. No. Now, take a right, Phil. You hooked a right. Said
she never said a word until the car bumped us on the back and went on, and I was in the ditch over there. That's when she said, you saved our life. I said, close to it. It would have been head on if I hadn't pulled that maneuver.
Glad y'all survived.
Amen on that. Let's take a break. So we're all gun owners, and we know that one of the most important things when you're a gun owner is to keep your weapon properly cleaned, like anything else that you use at that level, correct, Jase? I mean, is that a fair assessment to say
that? It's just being a responsible gun owner.
And so one of our sponsors is a group called Barrel Buddy, and these guys have been with us for a while. And here, if you're watching, you can see the package of their product that they use to clean your barrels. This one is for 12 and 10 gauge. So they have the product that fits any of your weapons, whether it's a rifle, pistol, shotgun. They cover everything. And it doesn't just improve accuracy, but of course it's the safe thing to do. It's kind of a mess to do it, but we know it has to be done. And these guys discovered this, just like all of us, by being in the field and realizing that they needed something better. They had the old patches back when I was younger that you tried to clean with, but you couldn't get everything out of there. Sometimes even the patch didn't come out. Then you had the boar snake, which was a better option than the patch, but not near as good as this particular product, because this goes in, makes sure it cleans out the grooves, and it also is composed of these white polymers, so you don't leave any residue behind. So it's a cleaner, and you're able to look through your barrel and see that it's scrubbed out and everything that you need. So once you check these guys out, they're a great Christian company. It really is important. BarrelBuddy.com, B-A-R-R-E-L, Buddy, BarrelBuddy.com. Check them out. So, Dad, you left out one piece from several pieces, but a big piece out of our Amish country trip. When we got to the airport, it's actually a little FBO because somebody sent a plane for us, which is nice, because I had to preach. I guess you had to first have a car wreck, and then you had to teach yesterday morning. And so there was this, when we land and we come in, as we're taxiing into this little, and it's a rural area, so it's not a very fancy little place, but there's an airstrip there. And there's an Amish buggy. You know, you've seen them with the wheels and usually a horse in front of them. It's sitting in this bay here next to where we're pulling into, and it has a jet engine on the back of it. Hmm. So we snapped a picture. We said, look at there, an Amish buggy with a jet engine. So we take a picture of it.
Most of the engine was in the back seat.
Right. So we go do our thing. We come back, and when we get back to the airport, the guy that flew us, he owns the whole operation there. He owns, you know, he flies the plane. He owns the operation, and his son works there. He's a mechanic. Well, he comes out. He's a big old boy. It looks just like a redneck. Anybody you would have went to school with here, Jase, that's what he looks like. And he's got a fire suit on. And we get there to get on the plane to go home. He's out. That buggy is out there on the runway. And he says, I'm fixing to show y'all something. So he gets in that thing, and he takes off with
a black wagon that mules drag along.
Did it have wings?
No, it was a normal buggy.
He is seated right in front of a jet engine.
With jet fuel
in
there.
It didn't fly. It was just for...
It was just for running.
It's 80 miles an hour on the airport. He was not on the runway, but he is moving. And boom, boom, cloud of smoke come out, fire coming out the back. I never seen anything
like a backfire.
Yeah. Oh. I mean, a big old plume of smoke comes out of it, like you see come out of a jet, and a big fire's out of the back, and he comes by, you know, like it's some kind of speed test. So I'm laughing so hard, which we got video, so I'm hoping Josh can put a little video on here for you guys that watch this on YouTube. And I even got the shirt. That's what my shirt is.
Sounds like a little rebellion over the, we're just driving a bus.
See right there, that his shirt? There it is, Jase. See that jet engine, that red-looking thing in there, the fire coming out? That's the way he looked when he...
The world's fastest buggy.
He went out and turned around in the airport, poured the coal to it, and come by us at least 75, 80 miles an hour. Well, I was moving back, you know.
Well, he's wearing a fire suit, so I'm thinking, I don't know, we're just standing out here watching. But I laughed at it because I thought, this is so amazing, because here we are in Amish country, and this is where redneck and Amish come together.
Oh, yeah.
This is it, because you're thinking, I'm going to get an Amish buggy and put a jet engine on the back of it and hold my beer and watch this. Oh, it was great. It was great entertainment. That's what sent us on our way. Then we hopped on the plane and came home. So I had to mention that.
I'll tell you what, they can say what they want to, Al, but that was really to get that pulled off. That was pretty good.
He's a pretty good mechanic to pull that off. My hat's
off
to him.
Very good.
But Jase, I loved it. I wanted to mention before we left that topic that a lot of people were still talking about you being there 2 years ago. And the guy that puts it on, it's a great recovery ministry called 612. It's based on Ephesians 6:12, and they're doing tremendous work in this community. And so it was a fundraiser for them. And he told me that when you were there, you know, Amish people, a lot of them don't watch TV, or at least are not supposed to. But he said a lot of them came to him and said, "Will you show us that, what, you know, that the podcast when the duck guy was here talking about being here?" And he said a lot of people came to Christ based on us talking about it on the podcast when you were there. So he said he wanted to let you know that. So it's good. The fruit continues to go on. And we shared the gospel. I mean, Dad and I both did, and Mom and Lisa. So it was a great event. We enjoyed it.
They were very good people.
They were, and they treated us tremendously. So
the best people I've ever run up on were the Amish and at Ohio up there.
Yeah, very, very good folks. So we loved it. And we got to see some redneck ingenuity.
By the way, some of them were asked why they are not using mechanical stuff, you know, on some of their equipment, you know, and they're just using mules and horses. And they said that the Amish who were doing that, their answer was,
your favorite verse.
We don't know. We don't know where this came from. This was handed down. Their ancestors handed down mules and wagons, and they said, we don't know why we, other than that.
He said a lot of them quote your favorite verse from 1 Thessalonians that says, we don't want to be dependent on anybody.
Yeah.
Oh.
But we want to live a quiet, godly life in Christ Jesus. So a lot of it comes from that.
Yep.
But tremendous woodworkers and, you know, farmers, and the stuff up there is amazing. Of course, Mom and Lisa went shopping, so that added to the.
I don't care what everybody says when they begin to say negative things about the Amish world, but I saw nothing but positive.
Oh, they're fantastic.
I said, this is the kingdom of God.
But you know,
I'm a member of.
I thought about that because that ministry that we were there supporting, they mainly do recovery it's mainly from drugs and alcohol, but it's a lot of other stuff. But, you know, even in the Amish community, they deal with a lot of folks that deal with the same thing. It reminded me, the evil one is working wherever he's working. You can't isolate to the point you never have to deal with him, even if you're isolated from culture. So that's we talked a lot about this in Luke, that evil, that's the way it works. It's insidious. I mean, it can go in any community. So,
by the way, after I survived the head-on collision, we didn't get in bed about 2:00 by the time we got down there. But so they give it 3 or 4 hours sleep, and I was back up there. But we converted a man and his wife and asked him what he did for a living. He was up there toward the Amish country. But anyway, he said he was an accountant. He was putting his dry clothes on in the little stall there after I baptized him. I said, hey, by the way, what do you do for a living? He said, accountant. So you never know who you're talking to or where they come from. They just show up.
Yeah.
He and his wife.
Which is pretty cool. So, Jase, do you know what you're going to say in the wedding tonight? Or
yeah.
Are you ready for it?
I crash coursed. I mean, it's family. You know, when I think of my niece, I mean, it's just hard for me to wrap my head around. These are two adults now, you know.
Well, and like I remember, and this one in particular, she's very youthful. Even though she's a college student, she's very youthful in appearance. So it does seem weird that she's getting married.
I mean, I'm keeping it pretty short because they said
that's best. You know what I'm known for? Short weddings.
Yeah, so I'm gonna go short. I mean, I'll give her a report. I got a couple pages. But I basically just made it Jesus-centered because they asked me to do that. They said that's why they were asking me.
Right.
And there's a lot of similarities of being married to Jesus and being married.
How old is Lily now?
21.
21.
22, something.
They're both about 21.
They're in the early 20s.
Yep. Right. He just graduated from college, so he's 22. Yeah.
What's he going to do for a living? They said he's going to be...
He's an accountant.
Accountant. So that's why I thought... That's where I thought you were going with that.
Yep.
But he is genuinely... I mean, if I...
He's a fine young
man. I didn't
know
there were, you know, young men out there of this... He's a quality individual.
High caliber.
I wholeheartedly approve of this.
Me too.
So I'm excited about it. I mean, he already seems like family. We're friends.
Yeah,
which is very strange because most of these teenage bucks, you know, you're looking.
Well, your brother's child is your niece.
Yeah,
your niece.
Yeah, you're really being Captain Obvious today.
We're going through all these zones that you get to, you know.
Yeah.
And now
he's hearing for the first time.
I'll get into your 80s, really. I'm almost in my 80s here, a couple of years. So I'm looking at it, and I'm like, okay, what would you call them? They were cousins.
Well, before we get to the Bible, what I originally was going to talk about was the miracle. Phil's got an ear, man. That's what he referred to him earlier.
Unbelievable.
And they had a little wax removal, and so now Phil's like, I can hear. That was the said miracle I was referencing.
When I came in this morning, Jase, I usually come in, bring Dad a little Chick-fil-A, and we talk a little bit before we come over here and do the podcast. So normally the TV, you know, it goes up to 100. Most people wouldn't know that, but I know because when I go into Dad's, it's around 90. I don't think you have it quite all the way.
Yep.
So I walk in this morning, I don't know what it was, but I would guess it's about 20. Dad's sitting there watching TV, and I was like, well, I guess he's just reading lips today. And you told me about Nurse Man had been there and what he had dug out of your ears. And I was like, so Dad said, look, I can hear that perfectly well. I was like,
right now, it's like you're hollering at me.
Right, because for the first time, you're hearing all this.
I had them wax, I guess, for a year or so. He cleaned them out one time before, but that's been a couple of years. But boy, did it ever block off my hearing. Woo!
So we sound loud now, right? Yeah.
Oh, y'all sound very loud.
Like we're yelling at you. I was the same way. That's why it was almost.
Was it both ears or just one?
Both ears. I mean, he would pull. He'd pull out that.
What percentage would you say you've increased in your hearing when it came out?
Oh, I would say 75%. I mean, I was just listening. Wow. I've got some expensive, you know, duck ears, you know, you put in your head. But
that didn't do any good when you're having to go through the wax. That's why that wouldn't work. I couldn't figure it out, Dad. You would put your hearing aids in, and I was like, he can't hear any better. They must be bad. But now I know what the deal was.
Oh,
too much wax.
Too much wax. So I put a little oil in my ears for the last 4 days. And a nurse man told me that. He said, he's one of the brothers, but he hunts with us. Well, I call him Nurse Man. I don't even know his real name. But anyway, but I know he's good.
You called him Ear Man earlier, which
Ear
was funny.
Man. Yeah. But boy, did he ever awaken a new world to me.
So Dad's line was, this is a good redneck line. I said, Dad was a lot of wax. He said, Al, if it had been peanut butter, it would have been enough for a sandwich.
Just globs of earwax.
Wow. Well, as you're enjoying your breakfast,
I was trying to eat a chicken biscuit, but I just lost interest.
Let's take another break. So there's a lot of talk these days about free speech. I think that Elon Musk probably, out of all the other things he's done with satellites and spaceships and all that, he's probably done as much by buying Twitter to bring that conversation back to the forefront, which we think is a good thing. We're able to share what we share, do the Bible studies we do and share Jesus because of our right of free speech. And so it's very important. Right now, a lot of big tech companies, social media sites, you know, they're not so much on board. There's kind of a big tech monopoly that goes on. And so one of our sponsors is a group called ExpressVPN, and their goal is to make sure and protect you from that. Because all these tech giants, what they do is the way they make their money, they're going to track your searches, your video history, everything you click on. They build a profile on you, and then they sell your data. That's what they do. And so ExpressVPN, what they do by adding this app on your computer or your phone, it's going to hide all this from these parties that try to take this information. So they totally encrypt 100% of your network data to protect you from eavesdroppers and cyber criminals as well. They're rated as number one on CNET, Wired, Tech Radar. So let's stop allowing big tech to revoke our rights to free speech. Why not revoke their right to your data? Secure your internet with the VPN that we trust for online protection. Visit expressvpn.com/unashamed. That's expressvpn.com/unashamed to get 3 extra months free with our exclusive link, expressvpn.com/unashamed.
The There's nothing right, funky what, or nasty about it. It's just
no. It's wax. Just it comes out. It's from drainage.
Well, it is.
That's kind of nasty.
He pulled out that first plug, and I thought he was coming out with
no. It is
eardrum. Because I mean, I'm like, ow!
Oh, it's a tool. It's
he
not.
Said, it's gonna hurt a little bit.
It's not pleasant.
Well, it didn't seem that way to you because it's yours, but to everybody else, no, that's nasty.
That makes me want to go get my ears cleaned out.
I'm telling you that.
Well, just don't tell me about it.
And it'll creep no, up on you where you have. I wondered about why I couldn't hear. I said, well, I guess you get old, you can't hear anything. But, man, that wax and that it blocks off your ears. I never
Luke,
realized it.
I remember
Luke
it well, Dad.
Luke chapter 5. It's making me queasy.
Yeah, we do talk about the Bible sometimes.
I know this is an interesting question, Jase, but why would God put wax that could close off your ear? Why would he do that? Our body is generating this and it settles in your ears.
I'm going to give you a personalized answer.
You got an eardrum on both sides, but you got blockage. Why would he put wax in your ears?
Right. Since you asked me, I'm going to give you a personalized answer. So that when you debated whether the earwax came from salt water or God,
yep,
it'd be a slam dunk to go towards the Creator. I thought you'd like that answer.
I think you may have a point there.
All right, here's the internet answer.
For some reason,
the internet answer. Earwax protects the ear by trapping and preventing dust, bacteria, and other germs and small objects from entering and damaging the ear.
So that's what he unloaded? That's all a bunch of bad stuff.
Protecting the delicate skin of the ear canal from getting irritated when water is in the canal.
Well, to a point. But it's like, you know,
yeah, well,
once
can't
it gets
hear.
Too much, you can't hear. So defeating the purpose.
But sometimes too much can build up and block the ears. So that's what happened to you.
That's
just
what
too
happened
much
to
got in
well,
there.
All right. Because you got to remember.
This says as long as the ears are functioning properly, people should not be trying to remove it and leave it alone. But if it begins to cause problems or hearing issues, it needs to be removed.
So right now, since I just saw the wax and a lot of it be taken from my ear, I'm shocked at how much wax it was. But so do they say, how long do you wait before
right.
you have this check?
I'm right here, Dad. For some people, a once-a-year visit to the ear care clinic is often sufficient. But for others, they have to do it every 6 months.
But Luke
so
chapter 5.
I like cleaning your teeth. Yeah.
Luke chapter 5 says, he who has ears, let him hear.
Well, Jase is moving on. Jase is having
that. They save your life. You're talking about saving your life. I mean, so I had an earwig get in my ear, which the internet, which you're reading from, said they don't do, which I did have that happen. But the wax.
A live bug.
Yeah. Well, and your other son, Willie, had a roach get in his ear.
It's actually one of those giant water bugs.
What if you hadn't had wax? I would have the earwig would be in my brain.
That's right. He'd just come on through.
So it's a roadblock for critters and other.
So there's a thin film, your eardrum, and this wax, if when that lays up against it, it's like mounding up dirt, you know, until finally it's blocked off. So I guess it's protecting a lot, but it's really doing some serious damage. I mean, some serious
blockage.
Blockage.
Yeah.
So
I had the same look. I was filming.
I would tell
Saturday.
Everybody have your ears checked once a year at least. Have somebody look in there because you may be. I'm thinking about these old people in the old days.
Yeah, but the ones that need checking can't hear you. So it's a problem.
So we're telling people that, but since they can't hear us, they're not going to know to go get it checked.
So I took a left. We were out in the middle of nowhere, and I'm driving down the road, and I keep seeing signs that says "Do not enter." I was like, why do they keep having that? Until I saw a car coming, drag race style, your story.
Yeah.
I didn't realize there was two lanes. I didn't realize there were two lanes to the right where I should have been. So once I saw a car coming in my lane, I thought, oh. So
this
I saw
you're
it
going
way,
the wrong way.
Yeah, I saw it. So I was making an example. It's kind of like your ears, you know. It's do not enter. It's not for things going in. They even tell you. They're like, don't stick your ear down in there. Well, then whatever you have in there, you're just compressing.
Which the worst thing they came up with, people did, and I've done it myself, is the Q-tip, because all that does is like, that's like taking the old days musket. That's like packing it in next to your eardrum. That's no good. So,
I mean, the what Luke I felt a while ago, that kind of pain for a few seconds, but it's when he stuck that metal tool in there and he said, this is going to hurt a little bit. I mean, I was begun to be lifted off the chair. I mean, it was rough.
So this has turned into therapy, near-death therapy from Phil. I mean, he's had a crash.
What a cold open today.
And now he can hear.
I've never heard any podcast individual say, you know what, I can just put that wax bull out of my ear. Because I know he has. I mean, I think everybody
there
goes
needs to
through
be more podcasts on earwax removal. That's exactly right. Yeah. It's an underreported problem out in America.
It is. It's bad. I had this conversation last night. I didn't read. I had this conversation last night because my sister, who you all know, that would be your niece, Phil.
She went with us on this trip. Yeah.
Oh yeah, she was there. So she said that one of the number one causes of cognitive decline in elderly people is hearing loss because they just check out. They can't hear, so like I'm not going to worry about it. So it's a big deal that you can hear. I mean, it really is. I mean,
you're back with us.
He's back. All right, now that you can hear, let's read Luke 5.
Right, well, hey, before we do that, let's take another break. So if you're a business owner and you listen to our podcast, whether you're earning millions of dollars, hopefully, or tens of millions, you need to stop and take a listen, because NetSuite by Oracle has just rolled out the best offer that we've ever seen. NetSuite gives you the visibility and control you need to make better decisions faster. And for the first time, NetSuite's 22 years, they have the number one cloud financial system that can defer payments of full NetSuite implementation for 6 months. That's no payment, no interest for 6 months, and you can take advantage of this special financial offering today. NetSuite is number one because they give your business everything you need in real time, all in one place. To reduce manual processes, they boost your efficiency, they build your forecast, and they're also going to increase productivity. So they've got a lot of power to be able to help you run your business. 33,000 companies have already upgraded to NetSuite, gaining visibility and control over their financials, their inventory, their HR, their e-commerce, and much more. So if you've been sizing NetSuite up to make the switch, then you know this deal is unprecedented. No interest, no payments. You can take advantage of this special financing offer at netsuite.com/Phil. NetSuite, netsuite.com/Phil. Get the visibility and control you need to weather any storm. That's netsuite.com/Phil. So we left off in Matthew 5.
Not Matthew.
I mean, I'm sorry. I've been doing a lot of studies. In Luke 5. With the section that I call the Untouchables, because we first looked at, in verse 12, the man that was healed from leprosy.
And you wouldn't want to touch him because it was against the law.
Right.
And
Jesus didn't have to touch him.
Well, and it just, you'd feel creepy about it.
Right.
Because they didn't know if the diseases were contagious.
But you made the point when we talked about him that when you control...
How contagious was that disease?
Well, but I think it was a variety of diseases. I mean, I think you're doing yourself a disservice when you go back and look at the Greek and the Hebrew of these words. I mean, it was various diseases of the skin and...
Well, they knew enough to know that some of these were contagious, so you basically want to say persona non grata.
The reason I bring up the point is you think about it, if I'm not mistaken, it's still here.
It is.
To this day.
It is, but it's curable now. I mean, they
or at least treatable,
There was this place in Louisiana where if you caught leprosy, they put you down there.
There was a literal leper colony in our state.
Yeah. I don't think there's a cure, but there's a treatment. Right. I mean,
Is that place there anymore? Is it?
No.
So it is treatable.
Yeah. It is treatable, and people can live a fairly normal life.
But I don't think it was necessarily the same strain of disease 2,000 years later. Yeah. I mean, they're translating this leprosy, but that was not the word. When you look at it, it was just diseases of the skin.
Right.
So, I mean, there's a lot of...
I see a lot of...
There could be a lot of
ads on TV about what you do about your... his leg being red shows a little.
Yeah.
Show these gals, you know, they show them their leg or their arm, and it's just a red, kind of a red. Then that before and after, if you just put a little of this stuff on there, you know. Good I don't know go. What you call that.
Well, I don't know.
It's a not leprosy, but it. I don't know what you would call it. What do they call that?
I don't diseases know. Of the skin.
That's right. Exactly what this is trying to convert. Yeah, the idea is that this made them isolated, and so this is a person you wouldn't want to touch, and yet Jesus touches it. Then we got to the paralytic in verse 17.
But my point was,
if it hadn't been treated after 40 years, you really going to look like a mess.
Well,
but you don't want to touch these people.
Yeah.
So I'm just saying, it's a wrong impression that you would even, no human wants to touch somebody with skin disease.
Right.
Unless it's your mama.
Yeah.
And she's only doing it, you know.
The one you were talking about is psoriasis. They have the commercials for psoriasis. Yeah. Which,
man, my dad's got that.
Right. And there's now a medicine that helps with it, you know. But yeah, stuff like
but
that.
That's an autoimmune disease.
Yeah. It has nothing to do with contagion. But you can imagine.
See, that's a lonely life if you had leprosy.
Oh, it'd be terrible.
That's the point.
You couldn't go to the temple.
And I don't think
couldn't
people
worship.
Run around these days and giving you a hug if they looked
well,
at you.
Well, that's the point of those commercials you're talking about. Because the idea is they feel isolated because of the way they look, and it affects their life. And so
that's what I'm saying. I brought up the point last time that it's like during COVID, if someone coughs within hearing, which would have been, it had been real close to you at that time, Phil. But you're getting away from those people.
Yeah, because it's like, have they got it?
Even subconsciously, you know.
Right.
It's panic in the streets.
Oh, there were videos of people on airplanes, and some guy sits down there and he kind of coughs, and there'd be people recoiled in horror with their double shields on next to them, like, oh, my gosh, this person is, you know.
Yeah.
You know, it's terrible. So the idea is that Jesus, this little section that Luke does in the text, the next was the paralytic who couldn't get to Jesus. But four guys dropped him down through the roof. We talked about that. But this is another guy that people would have just walked past. But there were four friends that said, well, if we can get him to Jesus.
Well, I still go back to my approach to it. During the COVID thing, for 3 years, we're still preaching the gospel, and I was baptizing them. And I told them, I said, they had masks on and all that. And I told them, I said, look, I said, you know, we're worshiping someone who raises the dead. I said, they say we can't get 6 feet and all that. I said, but the people, the powers that be, don't understand is when you get ready to baptize somebody, it's a serious thing.
Yeah.
So I said, look, let's just take our chances that God will be with us. We won't catch it. Well, I never got it.
Right.
That I know of. And I baptized 600. I got as close as you can get with them. But pushed them down in a pool of water.
Well, your mindset, Dad, was the same one that I have when I go on a mission trip. People said, man, you're going to a dangerous place. And I said, yeah, but I'm doing it on behalf of the Almighty. So if that gets me,
maybe I was just lucky.
What a way to go. What I'm saying is, even if you had gotten COVID and died because you were sharing the gospel with people and baptizing them, at the end of the day, you know what we just said at your funeral? You know what? He died doing what he loves doing.
Yeah. I never actually.
As a Christian, it is a different view of anything, whether it's pandemic or anything else. It's a mindset. You know, one of the guys, the guy that hosted us, and Jase, you know him, he probably hosted you too in the Amish territory, was telling me about he used to have to go back and forth to Minneapolis, Minnesota for his job. And he said they flew into a flock of geese one time, and when one engine goes down immediately, he said, and that other one was a little bit damaged because they went through this thing of geese. And so he said when the pilot was coming in, he kept having to kind of tip it over to keep it going, and he just timed it out and landed. But he said he was talking about how religious everybody got in a quick hurry on that plane.
Yeah.
But he said the guy sitting next to him looked over at him. He said, you must be a believer.
Yeah.
Because you don't seem like you're getting too out of sorts. And he said, I am a believer. He said, I'm scared. He said, but at the same time, I know where I'm going. And he was telling me that was an opportunity to talk to that guy. And I thought, that's really what it's all about. In the moment, you're just like, we believe, you know. But these are people that needed Jesus is the point. And so we get
By the way, there was quite a bit of persecution aimed against anybody that's religious during that COVID thing. Wouldn't you agree?
Oh, yeah.
There was a lot of persecution.
Well, especially because Christians wanted to keep meeting. You know, I mean, they just said, yeah. Look, we believe God's going to take care of us. And it wasn't, no, you can't meet because you might affect us.
Actually, they were right.
They were right. As it turns out, you're correct.
Yeah.
You know, it should have been their call.
The old guy in Florida, you know, straightened out. I mean, he just said, look, go on with your business and go ahead.
And I have to say, even Louisiana, our governor basically asked churches not to meet a certain amount of number of people. But he said clearly, we're not going to come in with law enforcement and force people meeting together.
Yeah.
Just so you know, which I like that approach. What he said was, here's what CDC says, but I'm saying let your conscience lead you, which was good. Let's take our last break. So we get to the third in what I'm calling the Untouchables, but it's this third example, I think, of an untouchable, and that happens to be one of the disciples. And so this is Matthew, or Levi, which was his Jewish name. So we get to verse 27. It says, after this, so after these other two, Jesus went out and saw a tax collector by the name of Levi sitting at his tax booth. Follow me, Jesus said. And Levi got up, left everything, and followed him. In verse 29, then Levi had a great banquet for Jesus at his house, and a large crowd of tax collectors and others were eating with them. But the Pharisees and the teachers of the law who belonged to their sect complained to his disciples. Why do you eat and drink with tax collectors and sinners? So they aimed it at the disciples, but Jesus answers them and says, it is not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. So what do you think, Jase?
Well, I think coming off the paralytic, he has this, you know, which is easier, for me to heal this guy or to forgive his sins?
Yeah.
Well, by saying that, you're basically implying that you have the power to forgive sins, which means that when you sin, you're sinning against this person.
Yeah.
So I think there's a picture in here. So when he gets to this, because, you know, the tax, I mean, I think that's one thing culturally we can all agree on, no matter what culture you're in. Nobody likes tax collectors. We don't like to pay taxes.
Well,
revenuers, that's what we call them.
And I think in this specific context, when you go by, because you got, you know, the Roman Empire taking people out from their culture and making them collect the tax, and then you have all this extortion going on because they're in a powerful position and they got Rome on their side, and so they have so many enemies from the people because they're being oppressed, and they feel like they're traitors to their own people. And so when you see Jesus pick out a tax collector sitting out here at the tax booth in a public way and says, follow me. I mean, that's just not going to go over well.
No. And you're right to point that out, because just like with us in the U.S., there were layered taxes. So you had the Romans who are occupying Israel. They want their cut. And it was just like the mafia. It's basically extortion. In other words, you pay us or we come in and besiege your cities and kill you.
You know, it's interesting that in that culture, I mean, there were factions running out of factions in every direction.
Right.
But I look around now, today, there's no difference, Al.
No. And that's my point.
This society we live in now is full of factions. Based on all that stuff, some of it doesn't make sense at all. Some of it just pure wickedness. But you say, there's all kind of factions running around out there.
There are. And so just like in our case, if somebody
walked in there among them and healed one of them in the middle of all this, some disease, there would be some excitement going on if you had an individual going around healing people.
No doubt. And so it's like you have, you know, you had the Roman government, then you had Herod and Israel. They're getting their cut.
Yeah.
So some people are collecting taxes for them.
Yeah.
Then we know, because Jesus goes in the temple, you even have the people that are supposed to be there for people to worship, they're getting their cut.
Yeah,
because you got to sell the doves and they're charging.
It's a money making enterprise.
It's a money making enterprise, and the old guy that's here is having to deal with that. And so your point, Jase, that makes these guys a pariah in their own society. Just like we would say today, who likes paying over half of everything you earn to other people for taxes?
Nobody's ever.
You expect to do some things for roads and whatnot, but who wants to pay all that? You know, it's just unfair, and that it was in their culture
too. So if you're claiming to be a king, or you're claiming to be some kind of leader, you just wouldn't think you'd make up your team of people like this. Now, he did leave everything, just like the fishermen.
Yep.
Including the money. And you leave everything, you leave everything.
And it's almost like, Jase, he was doing the big banquet was because, you know, he had had a little money that obviously he's collected. It's like he's just going to have one big last blowout and invite people to talk to Jesus. That's what it feels like to me.
Yeah, or he's trying to, you know, to
lead his friends.
The fact that he would go, because it says tax collectors and sinners, but in reality, we're all sinners.
Right.
I mean, you're not going to have much company if you do what the Pharisees said. They said he belonged to this sect, complained to the disciples. Well, why do you eat and drink with tax collectors and sinners? Well, if you called everybody that's a sinner, you wouldn't go eat with them. I think you're going to have a lot of...
You're going to have a lot of dinners alone.
I mean, a whole lot.
And even then, you're still with a sinner, even if you eat by yourself. But no, but part of that's the whole cultural setup here, that when you shared a meal with somebody... That was a very intimate setting, and it still is to a certain degree. When you invite people over your house, they sit around your table. That's a level that's different than just saying hey to somebody, you know, in a parking lot. So it was the same way here. I mean, this was an intimate thing. Jesus and his disciples went into this setting, and that said something culturally.
Yeah, I think if you put all these together, he makes the analogy that I can forgive sins, which is more weighty in the big picture, even though it wasn't to the paralytic in that moment, which I think is why he did that.
But instant healing gives you a lot of power.
Yeah.
So he was doing one thing visibly to promise something he could do invisibly. Because when you say, well, he can forgive sins, that's kind of an invisible fact. I mean, just think about it. You're like, well, anybody can say that. Who do you think you are? That's why it was so combustible.
Mm-hmm.
But then he starts using these analogies, which is ironic that Luke, who is a doctor, then records where Jesus answered them, because they're like, why do you eat and drink with tax collectors and sinners? So he's at the part. Not only did he say, follow me, but if you just look at this from 30,000 feet, you're saying this guy... He seems a little shady. And I'm talking about Jesus. From their perspective, they're like, this just seems shady. What's he doing with the... Because they're saying sinners. You notice every time you see it, it's in quotation mark. Because then Jesus said it's not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. Was he talking... That's something visibly. We're going back to the same principle. But he's saying, I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners.
Yeah.
So when he gets to Luke 6, and I'm going to fast forward just because I think there's something in the language of using sinners in this context that you don't really find anywhere else in the Bible. Because like if you go to 6:32, Jesus says, if you love those who love you, because he's talking about loving your enemies, but watch how he uses the phrase sinners. What credit is that to you? Even sinners, now this is Jesus talking kind of like we do. Even sinners love those who love them. And if you do good to those who are good to you, what credit is that to you? Even sinners do that. So you're like, what's he talking about? So verse 34, the second part, he says, even sinners lend to sinners, expecting to be repaid in full. But then he has a drop mic moment, if he had a mic, because then he says, verse 35, but love your enemies, do good to them, lend to them without expecting to get anything back. Then your reward will be great, and you will be sons of the Most High. And here's the phrase I was trying to get to. Because he is kind to the ungrateful and wicked. And so when you think about what he just said here,
he's asking for a lot.
He's referencing all these sinners. You know, why are we with even sinners, and even the sinners do this? And I came to, you know, not call the healthy. But then he's like, but I'm kind to the ungrateful and wicked. Well, who is that? I pretty much think that that's everybody.
Yeah. That's everybody. Let me say this before we close. I want to make one point, because I think when he says about the forgiveness of sins, it wasn't just that it was invisible. It was that he is claiming in that statement that he is deity. Because that's why their rebuttal was, who is this guy that thinks he can forgive sins? Only God can do that. So when he's making the claim that I can forgive sins, he's actually claiming to be deity. And so when you move into the story of all these guys, but like the leper is a great example of someone who, you know, is untouchable. Jesus goes to touch, and the one who can forgive sins, we should be coming to him, groveling at his feet. But yet that's not how the initiation happens. He comes to us first. Right. And so it's like this whole, like, the gospel is just kind of being played out here. It hasn't happened yet, but it's in the process, and it's a precursor of the full gospel, which is that Christ ultimately died, was buried, and raised on the third day. And so, but this is the thing, that Christ, the one who can forgive sins, God himself, instead of us coming to him for forgiveness, he's actually coming to us and dispensing forgiveness. It puts the initiation on him. I think that's what ultimately will get
done.
Again.
Well, Zach
made the point where I was going, but Jesus did that in an illustration. He healed somebody saying, I'm going to forgive his sins. Well, they're thinking God's a million miles away. And he was saying, no, you're looking at him.
Yep.
We're out of time. We'll flesh this out a little bit more in our overtime segment. If you want to follow us over, blazetv.com/unashamed. We'll talk a little bit more about this calling of Matthew.
Thanks for listening to the Unashamed podcast. Help us out by rating us on iTunes. And don't miss an episode by subscribing on YouTube. And be sure to click that little bell to get notified about new episodes. And for even more content that you won't get anywhere else, subscribe to Blaze TV at blazetv.com/unashamed.